Should we stop?
Sure.
Okay. I don't know, like, I just want to see, like, if does everybody know about LibreOffice, or is this something, like, brand new to you? Yeah, depending on what the audience knows, I want to adjust my presentation.
Sure.
You use it? Do you use it?
In fact, not use it every day, but several years ago, I use it when I got a breast cancer.
Right.
And I'm also a speaker of this club. And in our session, I and several other speakers also use the office file documents to show the presentation.
Right. Great, so you're one of the experts in the room.
So I just come here for this. Okay.
You can give me some opinion. Okay, so this is basically the agenda for my session. It's about 30 minutes. I think I'm going to run over. Okay, I'll start with myself. Okay, so as you can probably see that with my computer that was made in the 90s, I'm quite old. So I've been working in MIT for about 20 years now, and I've moved around quite a bit. So 20 years is a long time, right? So I've done everything from solution consulting, software architecture, and program management, and product management, research and marketing. So now, rather than working for other people or other companies, I run my own consultancy in Hong Kong. Making use of open source technology is integral to many of the solutions my company develops. Okay. In addition to the work stuff, I also have a young family, and right now my kids are at that age where they really like playing computer games and quite addicted to Minecraft, you know, I say. I just started introducing them to using Linux. All along they've been using Windows playing Minecraft. And then one day something happened. I don't know what, maybe the computer they have are too old as well. It just didn't continue working. They always change stuff, especially for Java-based software. Right? But then magically, when I put in Linux, their old PCs continue to work perfectly to play Minecraft, and now they're so happy with that. But the problem with using Linux at the moment, because I'm using like a very basic Ubuntu installation, so I haven't installed any special software on it. Right? With the Windows that they were using before, that was a parental control, so they have pretty much only a set number of hours every day to use computer. But now they know that Linux means that, okay, it's free, they know it's free, and then it brings them a lot of freedom because there's no parental control. But my youngest kid, when he gets up in the morning, usually back in days when he's using Windows, in the morning I block out his computer time. Now he just turns on Linux, and then now he's on YouTube watching. So I need to put something on it. If you know of any parental control software, please let me know for Linux. So why am I here today? It's because I believe very strongly in the mission of LibreOffice. So I really hope to help LibreOffice evangelize more. And it's one of the things that I think I can do as a developer. To help make the project better. I just asked this question already. Yes? You use it?
No.
Not often. What's the alternative that you use?
Google Docs.
So no more Microsoft Office, right?
When I work, I use Microsoft Office. I would just do that.
Yeah, it comes with it. LibreOffice. It's a free open source software, as you know, and it's available to download, use, and share, and distribute at no cost. And it's available on all these platforms right now. And it's supported by the Document Foundation. And uses the ODF format natively, and also supports the use of dozens of different file formats. So it's quite a good deal then. So, like I said, many people have never heard of LibreOffice or OpenOffice, but I guess our audience here is a little bit different because they into open source software. So LibreOffice should be quite famous. Usually, when we talk about Office suites, people automatically think about Microsoft Office. That just shows the dominance of Microsoft. But if you think back in the 80s, right? Microsoft Office was nothing. There are many products, different products from companies like Lotus. I don't know if you heard of Lotus before. Yeah, Lotus 122. Okay, they also had an office called the Symphony.
Yeah.
Lotus Symphony.
They also have some relationship with OpenOffice.
I know the relationship to them. Yeah. Only later on when IBM developed it. Yeah.
How about the program now? Close the program?
It's close. As you know, OpenOffice is now under the Apache Foundation. Oracle donated the code to Apache. So, even though it's not that famous, LibreOffice, but that just means that there's lots of opportunity for expanding the user base, right? There's enormous potential, right, for everybody. Because everyone needs to use, especially for word processing, to do word processing or presentations, like what this gentleman just said, like he uses Google Docs. So almost every person is a potential user and also a potential contributor to the community. But that's not very important. I always like to call LibreOffice is FOSS. It's similar to what people mean by FOSS, but it's philosophically different because we emphasize both the user's freedom and also free as enterprise. But oftentimes people think of open source software as simply free software, but that's not necessarily true. FOSS gives users power because two main questions. Proprietary software prevents users from being involved with understanding the software. So you cannot peek under the code, and you cannot hire a programmer to make changes to the code, even if you don't have a program. If you're a developer yourself, you can make changes to the LibreOffice code. So it also provides transparency. What exactly is underneath the code that this software is running on. So, LO exists because of our community. So people across the world, volunteers and employees of organizations, they contribute time and funds to build it, including the project. So, governments who support open formats, they want to give citizens a powerful freedom respecting software would be using LibreOffice. So the community is made of a great group of contributors. It's based on what we call a community-based meritocracy. There are teams in design, development, QA, language and localization, website, administration, documentation, marketing, outreach. Basically anything you can think of, right? So that's why I say, whatever your skill set may be, there's always something for you to contribute to the community office project. And by volunteering, you get to gain and grow marketable skills. So it's great. It looks great on the CV as well. Well, this is the official line from our community. It's, we seek to eliminate the digital divide and empower all school citizens to support the preservation of mother tongues and avoid proprietary software and platform blocking. We work to obtain our goal by providing unrestricted access to our office productivity tools at no cost, encouraging the translation, documentation, and support of our software in one's own language, which at the moment is published in 110 languages. Promoting and actively participating in the creation and development of open standards and free software through an open, transparent peer review process. So I'll just go over the ODF, the open document format with you. So this is a set of free file formats for office corporate applications, and it's actually an ISO standard now. And it was developed in an open process by multiple nonprofits, commercial vendors, and the community. And it's actually chosen by the UK government and the German government and the Belgian government as the official format for data interchange. These are the different formats for the different types of applications that use the open document format. Word processing document will be ODTs, especially with the ODS. There's an ODF format for all these different types of documents. So the interesting thing with the ODF format is it's a very flexible format. So the files are actually just zipped up files and directories that include formatted text in XML format, and also including the binary data like images and videos. You can actually open a ODF file in WinZip. You can actually make changes to it and make edits and changes. But you have to be careful that when you make changes in that way, you want to make sure that it still retains the validity of the file. But once you make the changes, it's best to save it again and try to open it in the URL office again. Just go over the Buckman Foundation briefly, since it's the supporting foundation for office. So it's a German nonprofit that supports, organizes, and deals with all the legal and financial stuff. There are a number of different, there's basically two projects right now that's under the DDF, Libre Office, and the Document Liberation Project. So it's, the DLP is a set of libraries that you can call to do conversions of documents into the ODF. There are memberships in the TDF. So for anyone who works on LibreOffice or other TDF projects, if they work for longer than three months, they can apply for a membership. And membership is not required to volunteer. So what does membership get you in TDF? It gives you voting rights. Okay. But you also have to be active in the project for at least 6 months. So there's a little bit of commitment to that. Okay. I'll go over some of the enhancements in 6.1 receive these first before I do the demo. So another thing why I'm here is because it actually coincides with the release of the 6.1 version. So it was just released a few days ago. there's two, basically there's two different versions of LO right now. One is Fresh, which is basically for early adopters and individuals, and there's Still. Addition is basically the supported addition for deployment for production use by enterprises. We can look at a brief development cycle of LO. It's during the version 3 release, the focus was on code cleaning, because the code base that LO was based on is from OpenOffice, so there was a lot of things that needed cleaning up. In 4, there's a significant amount of code refactoring done, so optimizing the code, rewriting some of the bits that are not good. And 5, it's focused on the user interface. And 6, the goal is for ubiquitous productivity. So let's just go over the top new features. So there's a new set of icon styles. Rasa Jaga and Oliver. There's an improved notebook bar, but it's still experimental. So as you can see, the notebook bar looks very similar to the ribbon in Microsoft Office. But at the moment, I wouldn't recommend you turning this on yet if you are using this for production work. And if you want to play with it by all means, you can turn it on. The image handling has improved significantly. As you can see the graph, the document load performance is much, much faster. You press and draw, and the draw menus have been reorganized. Page menu has been added. There's new drawing styles have been added, and legacy draw styles have been cleaned up. And also in LO base, it is still experimental, but in the experimental mode, the embedded SQLDB engine has been deprecated. Although it is still available, actually, I still use it myself personally. But now it's again replaced by the Fiber and engine. But I still have lots of things in SQLDB, and I don't want to take the risk yet of migrating to Fiber. Even though, yes, we try to encourage people to migrate. Personally, I would wait a lot before you actually do that. And also, the EPUB export, which is for making ebooks. EPUB is the format for ebooks. So they improve support for links, tables, images, and metadata, and fonts. And also for cover images and quick notes. And also support the vertical writing. In terms of platform compatibility, macOS has been the support on macOS has been improved. So putting videos in press presentation on macOS is much better. In HAL, image handling also has improved. So now images can be anchored to cells and can also be sorted. So as you see in this diagram. You can actually embed an image inside it in the cell. And when you do sorting, and the images will sort as well.
How do you sort by image name, or how does it sort?
No, you use the other columns to sort it.
Right, yeah.
It doesn't work on the image. Also, I mean, you're sizing the images within a cell, so because the cell can be of any width or any height, right? You can keep the aspect ratio, which is kind of important for most images. You don't want things to look very weird, right? I mean, you try to make a very big cell, a long cell, and then maybe the height adjust along with it a bit, and then it's all out of the whack. This function I actually use a lot, although I don't have as many records as they do, but at least I know that they're actually improving in terms of the performance of the lookup is much, much better. Okay. Also, localization, there's many, many more languages. I don't think anybody in this room speaks or uses Malay or Arabic, right? Or the other two languages, which I do not know how they're pronounced. And you use Prisian?
My wife, she speaks Prisian.
Sorry?
My wife, she speaks
Prisian. Oh, that's wonderful. Maybe you should give it a try and see if that English translation is actually right or not. Which tool do you think we should use to make a product called catalog? Yeah.
I don't know much of the choice.
No? Because one of my clients, he needs to build part of that catalog for this customer. So that's why I had to do this, right? So he asked me, what how can I do a product catalog that's updatable, and I format it nicely. Any guesses? No? No idea?
How are you?
Okay?
No problem.
Okay, so this is a very simple database problem. So we would create a database. Create a new one. Create new database. Okay, that's capacity register for me. Create a table now. And use the design view. First of all, has anyone used Base before? So this is like one of those things that you guys don't really use. Base. It's actually very useful. In the interest of time, I've made a database up for it. So whenever the table slides, it seems like the connection gets broken. Okay, so in the data, you create a database table. Okay, so create table. Usually you would go into create table in design view. I've already created one called product. Okay, so I'll just bring that up. Okay. So these are the different fields that I have created. So there's one called ID, which is the ID field is just an auto generated ID field. Okay. There's something called the UPC field, which is the UPC code for the product. And name is the name of the product, and this is the description of the product, and the price is the price of the product. Okay. And then photo is a view for adding the image of the product that you want to show in the product as well. So based on this. So once you created the table, you can right click on it and you can tell it to go to form wizard. Okay, and then you can create a form for entering form for putting in the information that you wish to add or update. Since the ID is actually not very important, it's just an auto-generated field. Violet. Okay. And let's call it product 2 or 4. This is actually pulling the data out from the table that we created before. I added some data already. Okay, so you can see this is the first record of 7. Okay, go to the next one. So let's say, okay, we can delete this one, the top, right? Let's say, or actually maybe we'll add a new one. Good. New record, okay? So let's.
Where are the folders stored? In the database or are these links files?
They're stored in the database.
Really?
Yeah. So you can delete the originals, right? Because So here, when you want to put the photo into the field, you just right click on it, and then there's an option will pop up, so it's called insert image from. Previously, I called it the Dark Knight, something like that, right? Dark Knight. Version 2, that's it. Okay, sure. Okay. Okay. Let's say the price is 1, 2, 3. Okay. So just save it. Okay, you want to get rid of the record, you can delete it, right? So just click on delete record down here. You see the bar down here. So these are the record controls. So you can go to the next record, previous, and then you go all the way to the last one. And then go to the first one here. And you can delete this. Once you have that, you can go back to the table and right click on it, and you go to something called the report wizard. Okay. And through this, you can basically build your catalog. You just select the field you want, right, and you'll put it into the report. Give it different labels, price, you can say $1. You can do different formattings. You can do groupings as well if you have group. You say you have a field for country, you can group by country. I'm not going to save this report because I made one already. So I'll just do that for now. fields and how they are positioned. And then if you want to create the report, you go to generate report. So there's a execute report. There's a button there. See where my mouse is, right? Once you press on that, it will generate the report by running it with all the records in the table. This is how you make a product catalog in LibreOffice. And to generate a report, it's actually a document that you can edit in Libre, right? Now, right? When you press edit document, it will take you into Writer, and then you can actually edit the things on it. If you say you want to add some extra thing that you forgot to add in the report previously, in the building of the report. That's how you create an ebook in LibreOffice. Last thing we should do is to create PDF forms. This is a function that I'm talking about, the fillable PDF form that governments like to issue. Useful for your customers as well. So what we want to do is to load up the special toolbar called form controls. Okay. So it's here. This is the form controls. So let's say we want to get this box, right? So, using that This box gives you a number of different options that you can choose. And then, so you right click on the control and then you go to control. And then you can add in the options that you want the user to have. Okay. So you go to the line called list entries. Okay. So there's a little bit of a trick to this. So let's say the first option is A, okay? And you want more than one option, right? So how do you do that? So once you you type in the first option, then you press Shift Enter, okay? Then Shift Enter C. Okay, so two options. Okay, we were in design mode. Okay, you can turn design mode off and then you actually play with it. Okay, so this is a drop down, right? So now see, click on the drop down. So these are the options we added, right? A, B, C. Okay. So you can select one of them. So we can save this as a PDF file, okay. Export as PDF. Do you know about this option, hybrid PDF? So it's actually one file that has the PDF and the ODF together. So because PDF files, you can update it, right? But if you incorporate, embed the ODF inside, then you can take the ODF out and change that. So it's quite useful. Then you go export. That's actually the end of my talk. So what can you do? What can you do actually? Is to visit our website and join the mailing list and all the different teams that we have on there. And hopefully you tell others about leader others and about boss. That's it. Thank you very much. Any questions? Comments? It's very hard to ask people to convert to ODF, I think. But it's still something that is positive. We should encourage. Yeah, but Microsoft Office has been in business for 25 years, something like that. So it's very entrenched everywhere.
Is there a mobile version?
Right now it's just a viewer. You can view documents
online.
Yeah, there's an app. Yeah. Only for Android. Nothing about the iOS. Although people are building it. But they've been saying that since last year already. Or 2 years ago. But there is an online version of Library Office, but that's not, it's a commercial offering. So I would say Library Office is still very much an offline install on device. I think in the future, even if they improve the online version, that's probably not the direction that they will go. But if there was one that's offered to publicly, would you use it over Google Docs? Version of LibreOffice for Android, that would be great, right? But right now it's just a view.